Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for being here in this beautiful spot in one of the great waterways of the world, which everyone gathered here is committed to protecting and celebrating. This is an important day, and there's a lot of important things going on right now that we want to talk about related to New York's water and our environment in general. I want to thank my colleagues in government and in nonprofits for being here with me today. Particularly, we're joined by Ulster County Executive Mike Hine, an environmental activist as well as a fine public servant, Kingston Mayor Steve Noble, another environmentalist, New Paltz Supervisor Neil Batez, I believe an environmentalist with a doctorate. So you are well represented here when it comes to the commitment of your public officials to environmental protection. We're also joined by several members of the Ulster County Legislature. I know there were folks from the Kingston Common Council who were going to come, and some warriors for environmental protection and environmental justice that are with us today, including folks from Riverkeeper, Scenic Hudson, Catskill Mountain Keeper, the Association of Native Americans of the Hudson Valley, and the Hudson River Slope Clearwater, which many years ago I actually was a crew member on. So, thank you. And several members of my own staff from the Office of the Attorney General are with us today. Marty Mack, who oversees all of our regional offices, Jill Faber, the Assistant Attorney General in charge of our Poughkeepsie office, and other folks who work with us from our Environmental Protection Bureau and others. We are extremely proud of the work that our office does to protect our environment every day, from the most local issues to the most national and international issues, fighting to ensure that those with a national agenda to dial back our commitment to the environment do not succeed. We're standing here today along the banks of the Hudson River, a river vital to our state, to the story of New York, to me personally. And I would like to remind you, one famous New Yorker once said, quote, "One of the reasons that New York became great was that it's serviced by many, many different rivers and waterways." That New Yorker was Donald Trump. And long before he became president and sought to empower a group of climate change deniers and anti-environmental activists to oversee our nation's environmental protections, even he knew that New York relies on clean, open waterways to thrive. But what is now being proposed in Washington would cause untold and perhaps irreparable damage to our state's rivers, lakes, and drinking water. And that's why late last month they ordered a review of the Clean Water Rule, which New York and the nation should be able to rely on for clean drinking water, for recreation, and for a viable fishing industry. Nationwide, the Clean Water Rule, which my office has fought hard to defend and protect, ensures clean drinking water for 117 million Americans. And during his announcement, Trump said that he was paving the way for the elimination of what he called the, quote, "very destructive and horrible rule," referring to the Clean Water Rule that simply would protect all of our waterways. This comes in the category of alternate facts. The Clean Water Rule is just the opposite. In fact, the rule that has been held up in court for some time now, and our office is actively involved in that case, is aimed at doing exactly what it sounds like. It keeps our waters safe and clean. It would be the fulfillment of a goal that historically has been shared by both political parties and almost all Americans. That is why I've led a coalition of state attorneys general to aggressively oppose the executive order to undo the Clean Water Rule and to protect our public health and environment. If we abandoned this rule, that would allow uncontrolled pollution of our vital water resources and harm our state's economy in many, many ways. Just coincidentally, the one group, or one of the few groups, that would actually benefit from this a repeal of the Clean Water Rule are golf course owners. I'm sure that's just a coincidence. But ladies and gentlemen, we're here today to express the fact, and I'm meeting with groups around the state who all reaffirm the same commitment. We are not going to allow our water to be destroyed, to be degraded, to our safe waterways, which we've spent so much time and energy successfully cleaning up in recent decades. We're not allowing them to be sacrificed just to make industry lobbyists happy. And the proposed rollback of hard-earned environmental protections is something we're just not going to tolerate, and I don't believe the American people are going to tolerate it. That, coupled with the proposed cuts to the Environmental Protection Agency, would be catastrophic for New Yorkers. I do not believe that this is by accident. I believe this is by design, and we have to meet this challenge head on. We know that during the campaign, then-candidate Trump stated of the EPA, we're going to get rid of it in almost every form. We're going to have little tidbits left. This is one of the most successful agencies and enterprises, the most cost-effective agencies and enterprises in the history of the United States. Many of us remember how dirty our water was, how dirty our air was, how we have come a long way, and ladies and gentlemen, we are not going back. So, in spite of the fact that he is placed in charge of the MTA, notorious climate change denier who stated today that he refused to agree with the idea that carbon dioxide had an effect on greenhouse gases and climate change, we're seeing the disastrous results of this worldview in their proposals. It's up to us to make sure that these proposals do not become a reality. Ladies and gentlemen, the president's budget has called for $2 billion in cuts, nearly 25% of the EPA's entire budget. 3,000 staff members would be laid off. That's one in five employees. These are hardworking enforcement agents. They're investigators on the front lines who ensure our laws and environmental protections are enforced. New Yorkers will see and feel the effects of these cuts throughout our state. All federal funding for beach water quality testing would be eliminated. A 40% cut to the EPA's Office of Research and Development would make it harder to track and address the types of water contamination issues we've seen at Hoosick Falls and other places in our state. The Great Lakes Restoration Initiative, which is reducing the pollution in the lakes substantially, would be cut by 95%, from $300 million to just $10 million, actually in excess of 95%. And the people of Buffalo, Rochester, Watertown, other towns along the Great Lakes are united in opposition to this, and we will oppose it as well. And grants that our state relies on to help build and operate and maintain municipal drinking and wastewater systems would be cut by 30%, a clear danger to our ability to ensure a supply of clean and healthy water for all New Yorkers. Here in the Hudson Valley alone, the state estimates that we need an investment of nearly $1.6 billion in wastewater treatment, just infrastructure, just to maintain our infrastructure over the next 20 years. They're calling for cuts to this. I'm here to say that I'm standing with my colleagues in local government. I'm standing with activists and New Yorkers all across the state. We're not going to allow these cuts to go through. We're not going to allow our progress to be dialed back. And I very much wanted to be here by the banks of the Hudson, which is a river I've grown up with and that is very important to me personally and tremendously important to our state. We are not going to allow cuts to programs to keep the Hudson River open, clean, navigable, free from large barges, and free from pollution. Without proper funding, though, ladies and gentlemen, communities throughout the valley and across the state will struggle harder than they have before to protect clean water and provide safe drinking water. Protecting our rivers and waterways is critical to the future of New York, and we're going to fight to defend it. We want clean drinking water. We want the commerce that comes on the river. This is a part of our way of life as New Yorkers. That's why today I have added my voice and sent a very detailed letter to the Office of Management and Budget, to the Director, Mick Mulvaney, to demand that the administration withdraw these proposed initiatives. There is no rational basis for this deep, broad, and damaging cuts, and it was remarkable to say that as much of an extreme climate denier and anti-environmentalist as he is, even the EPA administrator said this goes too far. That's really says something about the level of these cuts. The EPA represents about 0.2% of the federal budget, but it's had an incredibly positive effect on the lives of Americans in every part of our country and New Yorkers in every part of our state. Clean water, clean air, a hospitable climate, these are not luxuries. These are necessities. This is what we preserve. This is what we leave to our children. The EPA provides for this and provides assistance to those of us at the state and local level who fight for it at a shockingly affordable cost. And I'm proud to stand alongside my colleagues in committed environmental activists and advocates to call on the Trump administration to rethink its calamitous moves on the environment. I do believe we can beat back most of these changes. They don't have to take my word for it. Let me quote that same famous New Yorker again, who once said, quote, clean air is vitally important. Clean water, crystal clean water is vitally important. That was Donald Trump again. Somewhere in there, he knows this is wrong. He knows that this is something that every American cares about, that we care about for our families, that we care about for our future. We are calling on him to stop this assault on clean water and on the EPA before this is too late. And if they fail to undertake their legal obligations to ensure a clean, safe, and healthy environment for New Yorkers, we will fight, and we will not hesitate to use the full power of our office. My office has sued the EPA before. We're prepared to again to force the agency to honor its obligations under law. So you have my commitment, and I know that's reflected by a lot of my counterparts in other parts of the country who are working with me in a more collaborative mode than ever before to deal with the challenges we now face. We will fight for our environment. We will fight to keep the Hudson River clean. And I thank you for being here in this struggle. This is not the last time we will gather in this cause, but our commitment is strong, and I'm confident that we'll prevail. And now I'd like to introduce a great partner in these efforts, someone who has whose innovative record of accomplishment on environmental issues and clean energy issues has been acknowledged statewide and even nationally, Ulster County Executive Mike Heim.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. First and foremost, a special thank you and a huge round of applause for our Attorney General, Eric Schneiderman. A true leader who is genuinely committed to our environment. I'm thrilled that we stand here in front of the Hudson River. It's a success story. For those of you who are old enough to remember, it wasn't always like this. It was a place that had become an embarrassment from an environmental perspective. And today, because of places like the EPA and dedicated environmentalists all over, it's an extraordinary success story, and it's only getting better. That's a testament to the people in this place right now, the people of Ulster County, the people of New York. You see, I like to think of Ulster County as the environmental conscience of the state of New York. And there's a reason for that, because we have people who have stood up when it was easy, stood up when it was hard, and every time said, we owe a debt. And that debt is not just to ourselves, but a debt to future generations. We have an obligation to provide clean air and clean water for all that is yet to come. And as we do, when we focus on renewable energy, and we focus on clean air, and we focus on clean water, we should never lose sight of who our real partners are. And a well-funded EPA is exactly what our nation needs, because without it, we've seen the results. I think we would all do well to say to ourselves, would Pete Seeger be proud of our actions? And the truth is, he would be very proud of our Attorney General. He is very proud of the people of Ulster County. But I'm not so sure he'd be so proud of what's going on in Washington right now. You see, it's nothing short of a disgrace. The idea that you would cut funding to an instrumental part of protecting your future thinks nothing short of disgraceful. And so we are glad to stand with our Attorney General. We are glad to stand as environmentalists, proud and true, and say we are going to protect the environment. We are going to ensure clean air and water for generations to come, and we are going to do our best to make Pete proud. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Well said. And another great partner in local government and environmental activist himself, Kingston Mayor Steve Noble. Yes.
Going back 10 years, I got my start in the area of environmental education. And the very first grant that my colleague and I wrote was to the EPA to start an environmental program to be able to get kids outside into their parks to learn about the environment. And that program has now led to thousands and thousands of youth being able to, for the very first time, get out of our inner city, Kingston, and get out and touch the Hudson River, a river that we have all worked so hard to protect. And now those types of programs are being targeted and cut and are going to forever impact the lives and the education of our youth unless we do something. And so I'm so proud to be able to stand here with the Attorney General. And as you all know by now, this is not the first time that the Attorney General has stood up with our local communities to help push back against the Trump administration. You know, just recently, as many of you know, and I don't want to get off topic, but, you know, we stood as a city to declare that immigrants were welcome in our city, and the Attorney General stood by us, stood by Kingston, and has allowed us to tell the world that we want everyone to live in our city and to be able to be safe. And I just want to personally thank you for that. Thank you. But one of the things, as a local elected official, I run a water department. Where we work every day to provide clean, safe water to over 7,900 users. We also run a wastewater treatment plant where we clean that water and put it back out into the Hudson River cleaner than it came to us. And one of the things that we would not be able to have done is to be able to provide those services if it wasn't for the EPA, and in particular, our local resources at the Department of Environmental Conservation here in New York State, because much of their staff and their division of water is funded by EPA grants. And, you know, I was meeting with the deputy commissioner yesterday of the Division of Water, and one of the comments that he made was that if the proposed cuts continue to move forward, we are going to lose over 30 full-time New York State DEC Division of Water staff. And we can't have that happen because we will then not have the tools, the resources, or the connections to be able to provide safe drinking water or to be able to improve our wastewater treatment plant. And so for me, this issue is critical, and I'm really proud to be able to stand here with all of you today to be able to fight what I believe is a very important, it's the right fight. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And now we're going to hear from Haley Carlock, a representative of Scenic Hudson, one of the groups we've worked with closely to preserve the beautiful waterway you see behind you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Attorney General Schneiderman, for your leadership on this and so many important environmental issues, including advancing the Superfund cleanup here on the Hudson River. Scenic Hudson, New York State, and so many of our environmental partners who are here today have spent the past 5+ decades working to restore the health of this river and ensure that our communities remain vibrant places to work, live, and play. The proposed rollbacks of the Protections of the Clean Water Act could erode these decades of progress in both the environmental and economic health of our region. Without the Clean Water Rules protections, the clean water necessary for drinking, for hunting and fishing, for swimming, and other water-based recreation will be exposed to harmful pollution. Clean water is essential not just for our environment, but also for our economy. Outdoor recreation is a significant driver of the economy here in the Hudson Valley and is the backbone of the region's $5.2 billion tourism economy. Without protecting the streams and wetlands that flow into the Hudson, a source of drinking water for thousands of residents, we cannot address the most significant threats to this American Heritage River. The proposed budget cuts to EPA, Mayor Noble just mentioned just how many staff here in New York State that protect our waterways, that process permits, that ensure that clean water and open space in this state are protected, would be eliminated through these budget cuts. We cannot risk undoing these decades of progress that revived the economies of our cities and towns. The PCB contamination that has been a scourge on the Hudson River since the 1970s continues to threaten the environment and the public health and to stifle economic development. Attorney General Schneiderman and the DEC have urged EPA to require more cleanup, and the DEC has even said it would take on that cleanup if the EPA fails to use its authority to get the job done. EPA Administrator Scott Pruitt has actually been quoted in the Wall Street Journal as saying, "Think about how tangible it would be to the citizens of the Hudson River to fix that pollution." He has stated he supports an increased role for states in implementing environmental programs and has vowed to fight to maintain EPA funding to the states. Though, of course, cutting pollution, which crosses state boundaries, requires interstate cooperation and backed by federal authority, we hope that Administrator Pruitt will follow through with his promises in this context and urge him to find that the Hudson Superfund cleanup performed to date is not protective of human health and the environment, and to delegate the lead for this cleanup to the state of New York so that the environment and the economy of the Hudson River and Hudson Valley can be restored. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you all. Thank you for being here. This is the beginning of the fight, and I know the American people are with us. I know New Yorkers are with us, and I know that in the long run, we are going to prevail. So thank you for being out here to show your commitment. I look forward to being with you often again as we continue this battle. And now, if you'll identify yourself to Amy, she will take on-topic questions. I think most of us are still trying to figure out what's going on here. I have known him for a number of years in the context of other litigation I've brought against him. I do think there's a genuine conflict going on when it comes to the environment. I think a lot of people, even people who are in his inner circle, do understand that we need to protect clean air and water. They do understand the threat posed by climate change. And I think that there are some ideologues and there's some who would do the bidding of short-sighted, very short-sighted industry leaders. But I do think at the end of the day, this is an area where we can make headway with this administration. I think we can prevail on them that the environment is not something that should be a matter of partisanship. It should not be a matter of ideology. It should be a matter of science, and it should be a matter of commitment to our long-term public well-being. So I can't tell you I know exactly what's going on, but I do think that this is an area where there is room for movement. And again, let me emphasize this. We're talking about a tiny amount of money in the scheme of the federal budget that does so much good. And I think that this is an area where we have to be relentless in our efforts and our lobbying and our continued pressure on everyone who is present in this debate in Washington. I think that there's a good chance that we can reverse a lot of these policies. I don't want to prejudge anything in particular, but it is important to understand that the environmental laws, federal environmental laws, and the Environmental Protection Agency don't exist in a vacuum. There is a substantial body of law, statutory law, Supreme Court precedent, that mandates that the agency has to do certain things. And if they fall down on their duties, we have shown that we're prepared to sue them in the past. In fact, some years ago, and this was under a Democratic president, our office filed a notice of intent to sue because we felt they were too slow in issuing regulations to protect us from greenhouse gas emissions. The settlement of that case led to what is now the Clean Power Plan. So it is clear that states have the ability to enforce the law and to force the EPA to follow the law. If we have to, we will. We're hopeful at this point that we can accomplish a lot by way of dialing back some of these changes, but we are prepared to use the power of our office if it's necessary. And I know that we have had discussions with some of my colleagues in other states, and I do want to tell you that over the last month or so, the efforts of different attorneys general around the country to pull together on these issues is really unprecedented in my experience. I think there is a national growing awareness that we have to all pull together with our counterparts in other states to get this done. This is, we're talking about frontline cuts. This is not an agency with a lot of fat where you're not going to notice this. You're going to have the folks who do the actual inspections who are supposed to, first of all, detect these problems in advance, but also to follow up and study how something came about and do the technical work to provide for remediation. Those folks will be cut. This is going to have a real effect on real New Yorkers. It will make all of us less safe. I don't know how all of you feel about swimming in the summer, but I feel good knowing that they're testing beach water to make sure there's not harmful algae and fungus there. That would be cut 100% by these proposals. So they're talking about frontline programs, but the Hoosick Falls problem is an example of what we're seeing in a lot of different parts of the country, and the need for EPA frontline investigators, scientists, engineers to be able to deal with these issues is essential. That would be severely cut under the proposals that just came out of the Office of Management and Budget. Well, this is a matter of them making, they've made a proposal to expand the anchorages in the Hudson of large ships and barges. We have vigorously opposed that, and as of right now, I think we're doing pretty well. I mean, I know that Congressman Sean Patrick Maloney has been involved in pushing legislation to deal with it. I think we're going to beat this back. This would transform the Hudson into a giant parking lot for these big container ships and barges. So. I do think that we have an excellent chance to prevail. The arguments are overwhelmingly in our favor on that one.
Any other questions on this topic? Off topic question?
On topic and off topic, we just had this CSX derailment down in New England, Newburgh area. You know, any comments on that? And then also, to make it on topic, how would cops to the Department of Environment
Well, I do know of this. I'm actually going to be in Newburgh later today, meeting with people, officials about that, and discussing it. I'm glad no one was hurt. It does not appear that there was substantial environmental damage, but we're looking into it right now. The EPA is not directly implicated in rail accidents, but again, it's not the only agency under attack. So I think it's important to recognize that. We've made substantial progress in making our environment safer. There are a lot of outstanding issues. I mentioned Hoosick Falls. There's contamination issues in some places. We also have issues related to transportation of oil, transportation of dangerous substances by rail and otherwise. And that's something that we were beginning to make progress on. Again, I want to emphasize to all of you, because many of you have been involved in this struggle for years, how far we have come and what a success story this is. So I don't want to make this a wholly, this is not a wholly negative moment. This is a moment to celebrate successes, but also to communicate to our neighbors who take things for granted that we can't do that. We have to fight to retell this story. And I'm going to be meeting with people about that specific accident later today. Again, we're very glad that no one was hurt. Well, if it was just me talking, I suppose it would be pretty easy. But I think that it's fair to say that we speak for many millions of Americans who have risen up, taken to the streets, gone to meetings, called on their representatives with a level of energy we haven't seen in many decades. I think that what he is faced with is widespread resistance to the policies, some of the policies trying to implement, and certainly in the area of the environment, there is a broad consensus in the United States that we want to do something to protect our climate, that we want clean air and we want clean water. This is not a partisan issue. This is a completely bipartisan issue. And I think that he's going to face the kind of resistance to cutbacks and harm to the environment that they're facing in their efforts to do away with the Affordable Care Act. I think you're going to see real widespread resistance and rebellion on this front as well. And I don't think he's going to be able to dismiss it. And I think there are people around him who don't want him to dismiss it, who understand that this is not a fight they want to pick.
Hawaii has sued over the Affordable Care Act, repeal and replace. Are you going to do that?
We've been looking at this. We're in touch with our colleagues. And the bill has just been introduced, so they haven't actually done anything yet. But we are in touch with our colleagues about that as well as other things. Trump Care does not appear to be very popular now that people are finding out what's in it. and I would urge you all to adopt that nomenclature. And it puts people, it's going to be interesting to see, but I know there have been meetings, in this area where thousands of people are showing up at meetings that congressmen don't even show up at. I mean, this is really, which is really pretty phenomenal. So I think they're going to, that's another area where they've run into a wall of public resistance and public opinion, and I think they will try to adjust around it. Look, we've seen this happen before. They rolled out this un-American, unconstitutional effort to ban immigration. They were beaten back on that. They had to end up withdrawing it. They've come out with a much more modest proposal now that we are we're not completely happy with this one, but it represents a major retreat. So we have seen that they will back off of ideas when they run into the kinds of resistance they're running into, and I think that will be true of the effort to move this Trump care program into place. I think that the debate is ongoing. I think it most people realize it will make their lives worse. It will make their coverage more problematic, and you know, the American people are not dumb when it comes to actually being able to assess how things affect their own lives. And this is something that, as we saw in the opposition to and again, this is an example of what happens when issue really is joined. There was a lot of rhetoric about how bad the Affordable Care Act was. When you get ready to actually make a change, people start to pay attention. And that's true when it comes to the environment also. That's true when it comes to immigration also, when people realize what the actual on-the-ground consequences are of some of these policies. And I don't think they're going to be able to move forward in the direction they're moving on this or several other fronts. So in January, in anticipation of this problem, my office issued the first comprehensive guidance for local jurisdictions explaining what you have to do under federal law and what you don't have to do if you want to be a sanctuary jurisdiction, and explaining that there are really very limited circumstances in which local governments are required to cooperate with the federal government unless they have a judicial warrant, either for interrogation or producing people. We've also sent guidances out to local school districts to make sure they know that they still have to respect students' privacy rights and that there are very limited circumstances in which federal agents can question or intervene with students. So we've laid the groundwork, and I'm proud of the fact that all over New York State, there have been jurisdictions that have redone their sanctuary resolutions or local laws in line with our guidance to make sure that they're up to date on what the laws require. And in fact, our guidance is now being used as a model in other states as well. So we have gotten ahead of that game, prepared local jurisdictions. Our guidance also explains the severe limitations on the ability of the federal government to cut funding for programs. The funding has to be related to the specific program at issue. It can't be done in a coercive way, and you have to give notice in advance that if you make changes, you will lose your funding. So there are a lot of roadblocks to their efforts to do this. I would also urge, and this has been emphasized by some governments in this area and across the country and by the New York City Police Department, that from a strictly law enforcement point of view, our local governments and our local law enforcement agencies should be able to make the determination. We are confident that we are safer if we don't drive immigrants underground. Any area that has a large number of immigrants, it is clearly dangerous to public safety to drive that larger number of people underground, so they will not come forward as witnesses to crimes, they will not report crimes, they will not report public health problems. So we have provided the legal guidance, and we will back it up should those challenges come. But we're confident that New York sanctuary jurisdictions, to the extent that they are working to follow our guidance, are going to be in full compliance with the law. And I think, again, this is an issue where there's going to be substantial popular resistance to any effort to undo these efforts. We know what makes us safer, and frankly, it's something where the federal government shouldn't be able to tell local law enforcement what you have to do and you don't have to do if, in your judgment, it makes the people you're protecting less safe. So thank you all very much. Thank you.